Good evening. My name is Jason Wallace. I'm the pastor of Christ Presbyterian Church here in the Salt Lake Valley, and we welcome you to another installment of The Ancient Paths. It is our privilege to have back with us Mr. Grant Palmer. He is a retired employee of the LDS church education system. He retired after 34 years and published a book called An Insider's View of Mormon Origins, and that was followed up by The Incomparable Jesus, another book. It is a great privilege to have him with us. Mr. Palmer, thank you for coming back.
Thanks for having me.
I'd like to basically recap some of what we saw last week before we move on to some other subjects, because some people may not have been with us, and I think that some people may not have been clear on some of this. You were involved for 34 years in the church education system. You've been successful as an LDS missionary. A number of things led you into the church education system. As I understand it, a number of different things that were happening from the Salamander Letter, the Book of Abraham, or the Lost Book of Abraham, things like this, a number of things started you questioning the church's popular version of history and the original sources that you were going back and researching. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, it was a gradual thing. In my lesson preparations for institute classes, I would read a number of things, and it just seemed to me there were more and more things that were put on the proverbial shelf, and especially became troublesome when I was working on my PhD at BYU on colonial American history, and I began to see just how extensive the King James Bible was used and how much Methodist teaching was being taught by the preachers of the Second Great Awakening that were found in the 11 preachers in the Book of Mormon. That was a pretty good sized chunk of the Book of Mormon, and it kind of went from there.
A lot of people have this idea that the people who came into Mormonism were coming out of a Puritan type background, and the Mormonism was this radical departure for them. But you were seeing that actually, when you were looking at other contemporary sources, not only were they different from the way they were often presented in modern histories, but also they were right in accord with, like, the Methodist preachers you're mentioning and things like this. The Book of Mormon actually fit right into the landscape of that time, didn't it, in terms of the ideas of the origin of the Indians, the theology, the issues that were being dealt with. It wasn't anything new, was it?
No, not the Book of Mormon. The more radical doctrines began after the Book of Mormon was published, but you know, Joseph's family, they believed in visions. His mother and three of the children were Presbyterians. Joseph leaned towards the Methodist. His father and probably Alvin were Universalists. They had a dysfunctional family religiously, but they're pretty well teaching Protestantism, really, in the Book of Mormon. And that's what shows up there.
In the Book of Mormon, you actually have one God. Whereas by the time you get to the Book of Abraham, you have a multitude of gods.
Yes, from about 1820 to 34, Joseph believes in one God. In 35 to 38, he believes in two gods, and from 39 on, he believes in a plurality of gods. We know this from his early writings. You can tell where Joseph's at depending on what he's working on, what God he believes in. If it's the Book of Mormon, it's one God. If it's the Book of and the Book of Moses, one God. Book of Abraham, he now embraces a plurality of gods, and that's what shows up in the Book of Abraham. The Lectures on Faith, two gods, 1835. And even in the Joseph Smith translation of the Bible, he corrects the Bible passages to go back to one God when it looks like there might be two gods. So, I mean, you have a very interesting way of testing Joseph Smith, and that model holds up pretty well.
A lot of modern Latter-day Saints don't realize that the Lectures on Faith actually used to be part of the Doctrine and Covenants. It was the doctrinal portion, right?
Yes, it was in there until what, 1921? I'm not sure of the date, but it was in there a long time.
Yeah, the more you research, the more you find that some of the revelations are greatly extended, some of them are greatly shortened or even excised from the Doctrine and Covenants, aren't they?
Mainly additions. But there are whole sections that were given by Joseph that never appeared in the Doctrine and Covenants. I remember looking at what would have been section 111, 12, and 13. It was how to remove a church president if he had committed wrongdoing or was leading the church astray doctrinally. Today, they don't even talk in terms of it. They just say, well, God would remove him. But this is a very specific process of a group of stake presidents who get together and try the president of the church. That has never appeared in the Doctrine and Covenants, but those revelations are still some that Joseph received. Then there's others that have had additions. A few have been dropped, but mainly additions.
Yeah, the one that always jumps to my mind is, what is it, section 101? I think it was.
On marriage?
On marriage. That was excised. It said that we believe that every woman ought to have but one husband and every man one wife. And this was used to defend the church before polygamy was made public, but ends up getting dropped in what was it? 1870s, I think, when they finally...
Yeah, probably, I'm guessing 1870, 71, 76. And by then, of course, there were all kinds of polygamy going on. They even publicly announced it in 52 when they came west and entered Utah.
The theological issues that were being dealt with in the Book of Mormon were the things that were the subject of popular debate, weren't they?
Big issues of the time. Where did the Indians come from? And the Lamanites what is called Lamanites in the Book of Mormon, and Nephites, Joseph Smith very firmly believed were Israelites. We know that that is not the case today. They came from Asia, Lake Baikal, out of Mongolia primarily. But yes, this was a leading speculation in the time of Joseph Smith. He just grabbed onto that and has them leaving Jerusalem and colonizing the Americas.
I want to touch on this later in terms of some other things, but in terms of the Indians being Lamanites, I think it was about 1838, you had the LDS apostles make a declaration in which they said that the Indians were the Israelites, period.
And, I think that's stated in the Book of Mormon a number of times.
Yeah, I mean, it's very clearly taught that they are the source. That ends up getting downplayed a little bit in terms of the introduction to the Book of Mormon, saying that they were, I forget the language. Well, that's the later, that's the new one, but basically they were the predominant source. Mm. And then now, just in the last few years, they've changed the introduction to say that they're among.
Yes, well, you go to the Doctrine and Covenants, Joseph Smith receives 4, 5, 6 revelations on the Lamanites, and they're referred to as Israelites. And you're to go out and teach them. They're on the borders of the Lamanites, which was in Missouri, Jackson County, Missouri, and President Andrew Jackson had all the Indians moved west. And so Oliver Cowdery, Ziba Peterson, two others, they went out to teach the Lamanites, and we even know what tribes they are. I think they were the Pawnee and the, forgot the other one, Pawnee, Shawnee. But they've done DNA testing on these Indians, and that's not so long ago. That's only, four generations since then, and they're not Israelites, not from the Middle East.
Brigham Young, who was the Indian agent for the Utah Territory, he told all the Indians they were Lamanites, didn't he?
I think every president of the church has, and they say it when they dedicate temples, and it's really prominent in patriarchal blessings which the church gives to members who ask to know their lineage.
I'm curious about something. You know, you taught at the church college in New Zealand. Did they actually teach the Maori that they were Lamanites as well?
Very much, and they were proud of it.
So was their idea that they had come from America to Polynesia?
I think their idea was that they had had come from Hawaii. And there were several theories, but they very much believed they were Lamanites, Nephites, Lehites. A group had left the mainland here in America and made their way to Hawaii, and from there they took boats and ended up in, that was the predominant thinking. Of course, today we know that they came from Indonesia, as I recall.
One of the things I think that's striking, you touched on it last week, is that it's not that there had to be one source that Joseph Smith copied, but the idea that the American Indians were descendants of Israel is not something that just one other person had come up with. A whole bunch of people were speculating.
No, Ethan Smith promoted that, and he had gathered up the writings of 40 other authors. This is a very prominent idea.
He was Oliver Cowdery's, was it Cowdery's pastor?
Cowdery's family. I don't know how intimate Oliver Cowdery was with him, but his mother and siblings certainly were.
Yeah, they were members of his congregation there in Vermont.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so essentially questions about how the official history matched up with the original sources, and then how the original sources compare to the other things around it. And you saw that the Book of Mormon and so many of these other things, they had these contemporary sources that could have been drawn on to create these things.
Oh, there's no question about it. Joseph Smith is a sponge and a mirror. He takes from over here and he reflects it over there. He's very good at it, too. We know he used masonry. We know which masonry he moved. It was the right out of England when they brought together two or three strands of masonry. And we know that he used that. He joined the Masons in Nauvoo, and 5 weeks later he was giving the Mormon endowment, and it's wholly based on that 1720 version. It's the same thing with a lot of his ideas in the afterlife. I think came from Emanuel Swedenborg. Of Heaven and Hell was his book, and it was very popular beginning in 1808. It talks about little children don't need baptism. It talks about 3 degrees of glory. It talks about marriage in heaven. It talks about spirit world and different divisions. But again, you can't always prove, you know, where he got this. But we do know he got at least 25% from the King James Bible, because it carries the errors right into the Book of Mormon of a 1769 edition or later printing. I think we're pretty safe in saying that Joseph is very aware of the Second Awakening preachers, because, like I say, those 11 preachers from from Jacob Enos up through Alma 2, big chunk of the Book of Mormon, they're dead ringers for Second Great Awakening preachers, and you can test them in 6 or 7 or 8 different ways, and they all match up.
Even the first vision was a parallel to what you see from other people, even before Smith, in terms of, you know, going out to a grove of trees, their prayers, their claims of seeing angels or
it's very common. I remember teaching an LDS gospel doctrine class, and I started by saying, in the year 1820, a young man who's 14 years of age went out into the woods to pray because he was concerned about which church to join, and he saw Jesus, and his name was Stephen H. Bradley from Connecticut. And the audience said, "What? You mean someone else had this common experience?" And the answer is yes. In my insider's view, I list maybe 20 sources, as I remember, about young men who had this experience, like Joseph Smith's forgiveness vision of their sins. And then they went on and became ministers, most of them. That they felt that was their call to the work.
If someone would like, you've put together a really nice summary of the various sources for what you think provide a large portion of the Book of Mormon, Book of Abraham, and all. If someone would like to get that from you, how can they get that?
I think if you want to email me at granthpalmer@gmail.com, I'll send you, it's just a two and a half page summary of my book, An Insider's View. And I'd be happy to do that. And that's pretty much what we discussed last week. And that'll bring you up to par for what we discussed last week.
Is it also available on your website?
It is.
They just showed the link for that.
Oh, so. They just showed it on the screen.
Yeah,
actually. Yes, you can see this, and I guess you can copy it as a PDF file.
Okay. Now, you didn't stop with all this. You began to compare the substance of what Mormonism taught especially in terms of Jesus, with what you were reading in the New Testament. What did you find?
Well, that's a subject that, you know, aside from the foundational problems of the church, and I think they're serious enough, I think another problem is what you're asking here. If you compare the Mormon Jesus with the New Testament Jesus, you'll begin to see different personality, different behavior, attitudes, and even doctrinal emphasis. What I would suggest the listener do, don't take my word for it, but I think just read the four Gospels. Start there. Start with the Gospel of John, and Jesus will meet you in the Gospel of John, and then go back and read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and then the rest of the New Testament. But if you will disregard the chapter headings, just get a good Bible like the NIV, the New International Version, and just read it for what it says. And if you'll do that, I think you will begin to see some of these differences that I'm claiming are there. One of the things that was very useful to me, and I'd pass this on to anyone who's interested in making this test themselves, is I would like to see people I'd like them to see their religious leaders through the eyes of Jesus rather than seeing Jesus through the eyes of their religious leaders. And what I'm suggesting, this is one way to do that. In other words, let's see what he has to say. Has his personality changed that much? I don't think so. And here's just four or five examples of where I see a bifurcated personality. For example, Jesus, he drank wine. He provided at a wedding feast. They said the best was, you know, it was the last the wedding feast.
I don't know if you've ever heard the old joke that, you know, Jesus scandalizes many of his professed followers because he's at a party where there's drinking. And not only is he at a party where there's drinking, he provides the alcohol.
Yes. And he even says that those who are in heaven with him, they'll celebrate by drinking wine. I think that's in the book of Luke, I think. But you see, to Jesus, that's in the New Testament Jesus, this is just kind of the way things are. But in the Mormon Jesus, the Mormon Jesus not only doesn't drink wine, he makes it a test of fellowship. In other words, if you drink wine, you cannot get the ticket to get in the LDS temple. You cannot get the ordinance. Therefore, you cannot live with God, the Father. Well, that's quite an escalation of something that on the surface looks pretty simple. I think the same is true with tithing. It's true, tithing was in the Old Testament, and it was before the law of Moses. But I don't see any real evidence that Jesus continued that as a law in the early church. When he spoke to the rich young ruler, he says, well, you need to give your goods to the poor or a certain amount. And he says, well, I can't do that. But he's given it to the poor. When he talks to Zacchaeus, the publican over the Jericho district, he does join the church and gives a lot of money. The widows might. And so if you take a look at Romans chapter 16, verse 1, it says, you should pay as you're able. It doesn't give a percent. And then in 2 Corinthians 9, I believe it says, be a cheerful giver to make the work go. But there's no real law of tithing in there. But once again, this has become a major test of fellowship in the LDS church. You don't pay tithing, you don't get the temple recommend, you don't get the ordinances, and you don't live with God. So we have a bifurcated personality here. Jesus has a very split personality if you start thinking this way, between the Mormon Jesus and the New Testament Jesus. Now here's just a couple of more things that I won't go into very much, but let's just name a few. It seems to me that Jesus is constantly looking for how to include people rather than exclude them. And I think the Mormon Jesus is more often than I would care to mention, they're looking for ways to exclude people. For example, if your daughter's not, if you're not an LDS member, you can't go watch her be married. If you don't have a temple recommend, or you don't have, you're not worthy, you cannot stand in a blessing of a baby circle or a confirmation circle when they receive the Holy Spirit at age 8. They're always. I think these are policies, but it reflects badly on, I think, the Jesus of the New Testament, because he was looking to include people, not exclude them. I see a difference there, and you can see some of that. Legalism. I think the LDS Church in the last 40 years has become much more legalistic. You can actually start from the head of the top of the head and work on down. And I think Jesus did not like legalistic religion. He just says, look, I teach the things that matter most and leave the rest for an individual. He doesn't say, don't wear an earring if you're a male. He doesn't say, I'm against long hair. He doesn't say, I'm against beards. I'm against mustaches. He's more concerned with what comes out of the mouth that defiles than what goes into the mouth that defileth. And you can just go right down the body, and the Mormon Jesus has a prescription for almost every orifice of the body, and even the church issued underwear, and they want to know whether you wear it night and day. And I think if you sat around and talked about it, you could come up with maybe 50 to 75 of these, starting up here and going on down. And it's more of a legalistic versus a more of a invitational type of thing.
One of the things that's striking to me, I know I touched on this last time, but I hear it a fair number of times every year. A lot of LDS, or at least a fair number of them, still view pastors as hirelings of Satan, as motivated by money and everything else. We actually do believe in tithing, but we But we teach it as a matter between the individual and God. I purposely stay ignorant of what people give. The elders of the church don't know what individuals give.
Mm-hmm.
Our treasurer does because he handles the finances. But he purposely keeps that separate.
Well, at the LDS church, it's...
But you actually have to...
They just say 10%, and then it's between you and God. But they say 10%.
Right.
And people who say that aren't very aware of their own scripture, because in, I think, it's section 20 or 42 of the Doctrine and Covenants, it talks about the law of remuneration. And the law of remuneration is that if you're full-time in the kingdom, you should get paid. We don't emphasize that very much. You ought to try it on them, because it's right in there. Well, it's called the law of remuneration.
I don't get very far, because I mentioned people working full-time in the church education system. I mentioned other people working full-time for the LDS church, but that doesn't seem to count.
No.
I'm in it. I'm supposedly in it for the money because I'm full-time.
Well.
Anyway, I want to focus more on Jesus in the time we have left, but before we go any further, I want to open up the phone lines. If you'd like to join in the conversation, our phone number here is 801-973-TV20. That's 801-973-8820. We have with us Grant Palmer. He is a retired Institute of Religion director in the LDS Church, several different campuses, 34 years in the church education system. He is the author of An Insider's View of Mormon Origins and The Incomparable Jesus. I want to focus on what you were saying and flesh that out a little more in terms of the externals versus the internal.
Mm-hmm.
You and I may disagree in terms of a few things about externals and such and where that is, but I think we're in complete agreement that the focus is that it's not a change from the outward in. It's a change from the heart outward. That it is this new heart. I've never been a Latter-day Saint. I'm viewing things as an outsider. The impression I get, and I know there's a huge spectrum, but among those who are faithful, serious Latter-day Saints, there seems to be this mysticism. I mean, they can get very misty-eyed very quickly talking about Jesus. But beyond that, there doesn't seem to be very much focus. The focus seems to be on the temple. The focus seems to be on Fast Sunday and on all the various other things. It doesn't, and it amazes them when I say this is a different Jesus and a different gospel, because they're like, we have Jesus' name in the name of our church.
Well, they do drop his name. They close in the name of Christ. They sing about him in the sacramental prayers. But as far as the life and ministry in sacrament meeting, you very seldom hear a sermon about Jesus Christ. And the same is true in the Relief Society priesthood. In fact, I had the presidents of the church for, 10 years. And I think there's less than 10% of those lessons that have to do with Jesus Christ. They like to focus on institutional LDS beliefs and organizational needs. Jesus Christ just falls through the cracks. I'd say 10%. I actually did a survey on it. In fact, it's in the Incomparable Jesus, where I think I went up through 7 or 8 years of that. And out of 192 lessons, I would say less than 20 were actually talking about Jesus Christ. And part of the problem is they have 4 standard works. So they take 1 standard work each year. That means that they only spend in Sunday school, LDS Sunday school, about 4 months every 4 years on the Gospels. And then they move on to Paul. So they're not really spending a lot of time. And then it's often seen through the eyes of the Book of Mormon, so you don't get a much of a focus there. But it was Jesus who said we must be born again. And I'm not an evangelical Christian, and that emphasis is in LDS scripture in Mosiah and Alma in the Book of Mormon, but they just kind of choose not to talk about it. And yet it's the central teaching of Jesus in the New Testament along with the resurrection of Christ.
It's actually used as a pejorative among many Latter-day Saints. They're born again, or you know, they're, isn't it?
They think they're born again when they're baptized, but read 1 John, all five or six chapters, and he just spells it out. You're born again if you, and he spells out about six or seven things, and you'll soon find out that you're not born again just because you're baptized. And I really think that Jesus was not really caught up in your right beliefs as much as he was your right actions. And for him, the sermon on, he is the Sermon on the Mount. That's what it means to be a Christian. And that Sermon on the Mount goes back to one of those seven or eight Beatitudes. And the rest of the New Testament is going back and can fit under one of those seven or eight teachings. Peter has nine. He says, look, I observed Jesus for 3 years in 2 Peter chapter 1. And he lists them. And Paul has the same nine. And John, this is a big deal in the New Testament to be born again, to become a little Christ, as C.S. Lewis would say.
I'm curious. When you started reading the New Testament, no longer through the prism of what you had been taught, but trying to let the text speak for itself, did you see parallels between Phariseeism with their concern with the outward long list of moral codes and things like that?
Oh, yes, the legalistic Jesus versus not legalistic. Oh, I think he really detested it. And I think the last 40 years, the Mormon Jesus is, at least the church, is moved in the direction of legalism.
As an outsider, one of the things I try to communicate to people is how so many Mormons seem to set up a cheap, worldly grace where you know it's an easy believism in the extreme as the only alternative to Mormonism, and then lampoon it. Well, it's a straw man. In Mormonism, it seems as if you have to merit the merit of Christ. Jesus will save you from your sins, but you have to get out of them first, you know, to some extent. Cheap grace says, well, Jesus will save you in your sins, but he doesn't necessarily have to save you from your sins. He can leave you to wallow in them for the rest of your life. The gospel presents that Jesus will save us in our sins. He says to the Pharisees, the prostitutes and tax collectors will enter the kingdom before you because they repented. He'll save us in our sins, but he doesn't leave us there. He gives us that new heart. He gives us that new birth.
Yeah, the new birth and his grace. We can't do it on our own.
Okay.
And
let me go ahead and squeeze in our first call here. We have with us Greg from Roy. Greg, good to have you with us.
Well, thank you. Hey, this is for Grant. Grant, excuse me, I just want to tell you thank you for the two books you wrote. For many years, I was troubled over things that just confused me about the gospel and about the church and, you know, things in the Book of Mormon. And when I finally read your book, it just answered so many questions and cleared things up for me. And, you know, I've gone to my bishop many times and asked questions, and they just get mad at you. And you know, I'll tell you not to worry about it. And so I wouldn't. And I just have faith. But so anyway, I just want to tell you thanks. I really appreciate you. You know, for several years now, I've wanted to tell you thank you. And so, thanks, Grant. I appreciate you. God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's very kind of you.
If you'd like to join in the conversation, the phone number here is 801-973-TV20. That's 801-973-8820. I'm curious for your take on this as well. In the Bible, I see Jesus as the end. In Mormonism, to a great extent, when you get past a lot of the sentimentality, a lot of the emotion, the other things, it just seems as if Jesus is a means to an end.
Well,
do you think that's a fair assessment?
It depends on the individual, but I think you're pretty much right. Jesus Christ is enough, and Joseph Smith doesn't matter. That's two ways of putting it. Again, just take a look at the Bible. What does Jesus say about charity? He says, do it in secret. He didn't say take a reporter with you when you're going to do charity and humanitarian aid.
Yeah.
And there are just so many different behaviors of the New Testament versus the Mormon Jesus. It starts to, I mean, we're talking about several dozen here. I'm just bringing out a few.
I mean, the whole antithesis section of the Sermon on the Mount, where he's really striking at this focus on the externals among the Pharisees.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Don't mar your face so that people know you're fasting. Yeah. Don't make these long prayers and
What does Jesus call them? He says, "These are traditions of the elders. Ignore them." These are straining at gnats. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, they're hypocrites, which is a term that we don't often understand the root of it. They're actors. They're doing these things to be seen by other people. They don't, Jesus makes clear the only audience that really matters is God.
Yeah.
And he's a whole lot more demanding than legalists like to think.
Mm. Well, and the Mormon Jesus is not only more legalistic, he's more authoritarian. He's almost like a CEO. And Jesus gets down among the people. And, in all fairness, this was a small group back then, and it's a big church now. But if you go into even 3rd Nephi, which is a comparable time period to the New Testament, when Jesus appears, notice as you start reading, say, chapter 18, I command you to do this, and I command you to do that. And Jesus is invitational when he's talking to believers. The New Testament Jesus is not near as authoritarian as the 3rd Nephi. Go to 3rd Nephi 18, and they'll say, well, Jesus says, you may not be able to take the sacrament. Your religious leaders, ecclesiastical leaders, may decide that for you. In the New Testament, it's between you and God. Period. Because no one's, they just leave it that way. It's more between you and God. In 3rd Nephi, your ecclesiastical leaders can make that decision who does and does not take the sacrament. Notice how many times, even in the Sermon on the Mount in 3rd Nephi, it's verily, verily, I say this, but really, really notice how many times Jesus is invitational in the New Testament and how I command you to do this and I command you to do that. It's a different. And if you look at 3rd Nephi 9, where 16 cities are destroyed, it almost sounds like Jesus is almost an Old Testament vindictive God, and he almost seems to have joy in how this city, and I personally caused this city, Zarahemla, to burn with fire, and this one slipped into the sea, and this one was buried with mud, and so forth and so on. Anyway, just I don't want to make a black and white distinction, but I think it reflects Joseph Smith's personality, because he was more that way. He was more authoritarian and more that way. But anyway, there's another difference. There are all kinds of differences, and I would hope that the reader would or the listener tonight would do their own study. I think this is important stuff. So you'll find a different personality, different attitudes, different behavior, and different doctrinal emphasis. I think why the born again, to be born again, you must be born again, Jesus says in John 7 or 3:7. I've asked four or five people in this past week, what do you think is the number one teaching of Mormonism? They say to be obedient to their leaders. Well, that's really, I'm sure there's room for disagreement there.
I want to flesh this out. Let me preface it. We're going to take some phone calls in between, but let me preface before we take the phone calls. In the Bible, I see basically Jesus standing between us and the church in a sense, in that Jesus calls us to himself, and through him we're united with the church. Whereas in Mormonism, it seems as if the church has been put between us and Jesus. And in the Bible, Jesus is saying, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, I will give you rest. It's very personal, very direct, one mediator between God and man. Let's come back to that. I want to not lose my train of thought there, but let's take take some more calls. We have first Herman from Provo. Herman, good to have you with us. Herman?
Yes. Hello.
You're on the air.
Hello.
You're on the air.
Okay, I have a question to ask you. I have a really good friend. His son got married in the temple, in Manti Temple. And I talked to his father, and he had tears in his eyes. And I asked, what's the matter? He says, well, Herman, he says, I cannot go see my son get married in the Manti Temple because I don't pay my tithing. Now, is that fair? It just upsets me when I see something like that. Jesus didn't want us to do that.
Well, you're right on. Yeah.
It really hurts my feelings that his wife, his mother, and his dad had tears in his eyes when he talked to me. He says, Herman, I feel very bad. I cannot see my son get married in the temple.
And that's just a policy. That's not a doctrine. It's a policy.
It's not a doctrine, but you got to have your ticket to go into the temple to see his son get married.
Yeah, I think it's a matter of control. They like to control. I'm sure they have other reasons, but these are things that they could separate. They could separate doctrine from culture and policy, and I think they need to do a good deal of that, separate it out.
Herman, thank you for the call. We're going to go next to Bill in Provo. Bill, good to have you with us this evening.
Hello?
You're on the air.
I can't hear you.
You're on the air.
Hello?
Go ahead.
Hello?
Go ahead.
My question is, first of all, I have a question and a comment. Is Grant Palmer a member of the LDS Church still?
I just feel like I've graduated from the LDS Church. I haven't gone for about 7 years, actually.
So have you been excommunicated? Or?
No, I haven't been excommunicated. I was disfellowshipped in 2004 for writing my book, An Insider's View of Mormon Origins.
Well, I think it's important that the people that are watching your TV show need to know that, because a lot of the things that you're saying are false and they don't represent the church. And a lot of people are going to watch the show thinking everything you say is what the LDS Church actually teaches. For example, what you said about Jesus Christ. I go to the LDS Church and we talk about Jesus Christ every single Sunday.
You know, some wards actually do, but if you interviewed 100 people, you're going to get a large majority that won't agree with you.
But you're talking about people. You're not talking about the church. You're talking about people that make mistakes.
No, it's not about a matter of making mistakes. It's a matter about what you want to set for a policy. Do you want to focus more on Jesus Christ or not? And right now, they choose to let... You know, they will assign people to talk about principles, but principles detached from Jesus. You can find all these principles attached to Jesus Christ, and principles are always more interesting when they're part of a person's life rather than just off by themselves. But you're right. There are congregations that talk about Jesus on a regular basis. If you ask a lot of people, well, does Mormons really celebrate Easter Sunday? A lot of Mormons say, not really.
Easter is huge for us. The resurrection of Christ is one of the biggest days of the year for us.
I'd have to disagree with you on that. While they say that, they don't show it in their meetings on Sunday morning. Maybe your ward does, but I'm just saying, if you ask 100 Mormons from a wide range, ask them what happens on Easter Sunday, they will probably say there's not a lot going on. In fact, sometimes they'll have fast and testimony meetings on Easter or state conference, and Jesus gets a pretty short shrift.
This is one of the things that I hear a lot from folks. Whenever there's any criticism And I mean, even when you're quoting their own sources, often you will hear people say that, well, that's not true. You're misinformed. But you've been a Mormon for how long?
70 years.
Your whole life, your family on all sides goes back to the pioneers, basically. And yet, you know, the criticism from the fair folks, the LDS Apologetics website, is that you're not an insider. And, you know, here's a young man saying that you're not accurately representing things, and yet this is what I hear from a host of people, including active LDS. And, I mean, there have been some changes. We'll talk about those if time permits, but no critic is ever giving the truth. Except when you start actually sitting down and trying to quantify things, and then you find out they really are telling the truth. Let's go to our next call.
Well, I've certainly been around. I spent 3 years in New Zealand in the church. I spent 2 years in Virginia, North Carolina. I lived in Northern California, Southern California, New Zealand. I've been around the church. It's not like I kept my eyes shut. These are observations of my lifetime.
Going to Ray and Murray. Ray, good to have you with us.
I'm here.
You're on the air.
Good evening. Okay, thank you. I had to get the TV turned off. Ed, you referred a few minutes ago to some scriptures about being born again, and I'm sorry, but he didn't give the references to those. I would be very, and I'm sure they're there. I'm very interested in those. He said that there were 8 or 9 things that he listed that were the same in 2 or 3 different places that he said. I just like the references for those. And if you can't get the exact chapter and verse, just say what they are so I can look them up. I'd appreciate that.
What, Gospel of John, chapter 3, what is it, verse
19? John 3:7.
3:7.
You must be born again. The Sermon on the Mount is what Jesus is saying is the definition of a Christian. 2 Peter chapter 1. Peter gives 9 things, and then Paul, I think it's in Galatians 5,
yeah,
22 and 3.
Works of the flesh, the fruit of the spirit.
And then 1 John, look at what it means. The whole small book talks about the importance of being born again and describes the born again person. But the thing that Jesus wants to focus on, and if you'd like a more fleshed out,
hopefully he turned his TV back up. Sorry.
Version of that. I recommend you get for $10, you can buy The Incomparable Jesus, and it goes into great lengths on this subject. Here's something I observed when I read the New Testament through, just what it says. I was amazed how many times Jesus said the following. He was desirable that they focus their behavior on him. Notice how many times. Come unto me, learn of me, continue with me, draw nigh unto me, come after me, watch with me, hearken unto me, look unto me, follow me, hear me, confess me, gather with me, remember me, seek me, believe on me, find me, live by me, know me, serve me, see me, receive me, love me, dwell in me, honor me, abide in me, ask me, testify on me, and be witnesses unto me. I am the way and the truth. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And he is very much a jealous God that way. And that's why he wants you to focus on his life. And when you begin to look at his parables and his teachings, it tells you something about Jesus Christ himself, about his person, about his personality, and what he thinks is important. And then and you go from there. That's what it means to be a Christian. And when you take on sufficiently those characteristics, his promises are that my peace I give unto you. Secondly, what is my spirit shall teach, bring all things to remember whatsoever I have said. I will love you and manifest myself in your life. And what's the fourth one? Let's see. My spirit shall teach you. Oh, I mentioned that one. I am with you always. Those are great promises, and you really can't overcome the world without His guiding grace and emphasis, which He will provide when He sees that you're trying to do these eight or nine things that Peter, Paul, John, and Jesus all talk about.
Well, that being born again is actually Him coming in and dwelling us.
Yes.
I mean,
infusing us with His feeling and spirit.
Paul says, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me.
Yes.
And going back
putting
to...
Putting on Christ.
Right. This is what I was talking about earlier. It seems as if there's this tendency to put, in LDS view, to put the church between us and Christ. The flip side of it, on the evangelical side, I get very frustrated when I hear what often passes as evangelism when people tell Latter-day Saints, you don't need a church, all you need is Jesus. They're partially correct, but to some extent they're divorcing the bridegroom from the bride, they're severing the head from the body.
Well, groups of people can do things that individuals can't do, and so hence the need of a church.
But rather than coming to Christ through the LDS church, the biblical picture is we come to Christ directly. As you just said, come to me, I'm with you always, the focus there on the personal. It's coming through Him and being united to Him that we're then also united with His people.
Mm.
But it's a result. It's not going through the church to get to Him. If so to speak, does that make sense?
I don't know that resonates with me as much as
I'm an outsider, and I have a different mindset.
I found
mindset.
Jesus Christ in the LDS Church, but I had to really work at it on my own, and I think that's probably enough to say on that.
Let me try to squeeze in one more call here. We're running short on time. We have Joanne from North Ogden. Joanne?
Hello.
You're on the air.
Yes.
You need to be brief. We're running out of time.
I wanted to ask Mr. Palmer about Ethan Smith. I've heard of him, and I don't know much, but I have heard that he wrote the Book of Mormon.
Okay.
Oh, he was actually a congregational preacher up in Vermont. And Oliver Cowdery's family were members of his congregation. And we talked quite a bit about that last week. And if you want to learn more about that, go to Book of Mormon Studies by B.H. Roberts, or my book, An Insider's View of Mormon Origins, talks more about that. I'd like to finish up more on what we're talking about Jesus here, because it's not just what He taught. Jesus gave eight discourses. And His eighth discourse is in Matthew 24 and 5. And this is just a few days before they crucify, the state crucifies Him. And He says, and they come to Him privately, and He says, tell us, when are you going to return? And how are you going to judge mankind? And Jesus gives these three parables, and they're a very practical thing. The first parable is the 10 virgins, and He simply says, five were foolish and five were wise. The five that were foolish, they don't know me. And that's coming back to what I've been talking about most of the night. They were not born again. They did not take upon the moral image of Christ. And He says, you won't be going to heaven if you don't take upon yourself the nature of Christ. The second is about the parable of the pounds. And remember, He gave 1 pound, 2 pounds, 5 pounds. And then He says, I went on a long journey and I came back. It means I'm not coming right away from your point of view. But when He comes back, he has an accounting of his stewards, and the person who had two and five doubled them, but the one who had one did nothing, he buried it. So the second thing I think He's looking at, besides taking upon ourselves the image of Christ, being born again, the second focus is in that parable of the pounds, and He says, I want to know what you've done with your life and time on earth. And then the third one is the parable of the sheep and the goats. And this is where He says, when I come back, I'll divide all nations between the sheep and the goats. And then He defines what a sheep is. And it's a person who feeds the poor, helps the widows, visits the prisoners, and so forth and so on. I think those are important. And then he does the flip side of that and says, goats are those who do not do that. But if you've done it unto the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. Notice what he doesn't say in there. He doesn't say, well, now, did you pay all this money? Did you have all these higher ordinances? Did you go to the temple? Did you do this? Did you pay this money? No, it's a very pragmatic thing, and that's the way I see Jesus. And he's the one that says he's going to judge us. So I think we ought to take a serious look at Matthew 25, because he is saying what he's going to be looking for. The image of God. What have you done with your time and talents? And did you help? Were you part of the answer or part of the problem on the earth? That's who makes it to heaven.
Well, we're unfortunately out of time. The hour goes quickly. But it has been a great privilege to have you with us. If anyone would like to see more on these things, you have a website that we'll put back up here. And your two books are An Insider's View of Mormon Origins and The Incomparable Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you so much for being with us. Our show is sponsored by Christ Presbyterian Church. We are a congregation of the Orthodox Presbyterian denomination. We believe the Bible is the Word of God. It is our only infallible rule of faith and practice. We try to go through those scriptures and see Jesus on a regular basis. If you'd like more information, you can go to our website, www.christpres.net, or you can give us a call at 801-969-7948. We meet Sunday mornings at 11 a.m., Sunday evenings at 5:30 p.m. at 8630 West, 2700 South, Main Street, Magna, and we have a sister congregation in Ogden, Berean Presbyterian Church. We invite you to worship with us soon. Until next time, we wish you the Lord's greatest blessings. Good night.
Hear, O hear.